The Lord be with you.
And
greetings and welcome to all of you. Glad you are here with us and also those who are watching from home. We are taking all precautions, as you know. We invite you or encourage you to wear a mask. If you don't wear a mask, then please commune last. That's one way that we can kind of care for one another here. When it comes time for communion, the elements will be brought down. The elder will commune first and has an example you'll see. We invite you to take the mask down, then do the sanitizer, then come up, receive the bread and the wine, and then move over here. I will speak the words and then dismiss to the car. If you don't take the mask down before you get there, you won't have an extra hand. So I've been watching how it works. It doesn't quite work that way. Also, the children are invited forward and they'll be blessed also at the rail. The order of service is as printed. We encourage you at home to also sing and pray with us as we celebrate the Holy Trinity this morning. Our first hymn is in the bulletin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. Since you're gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Merciful Father, in holy baptism, you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church, in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity and the undivided unity. Let us give glory to him, because he has shown his mercy to us. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity and the undivided unity. Let us give glory to him, because he has shown his mercy to us. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you have given us grace to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity by the confession of a true faith, and to worship the unity and the power of the divine majesty. Keep us steadfast in this faith and defend us from all adversities. For you, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, live and reign one God, now and forever. Amen. The Old Testament reading for the festival of the Holy Trinity is from Genesis chapters 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse, and it was so. And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening and there was morning the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the heavens be gathered into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, "Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit, trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind on the earth." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. And God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens. So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply and fill the waters in the seas and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds. And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God finished his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is from Acts chapter 2. Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know, this Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will dwell in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to Hades or let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would not set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, And having received from God, having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand to greet the Holy Gospel, saying, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. These things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 28th chapter. To you, O Christ. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated for our sermon hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Please be seated. One of the benefits of lockdowns and sheltering orders is couch church. You can have a giant coffee and a donut while you're praying. You don't have to shave or really even get dressed. You don't have to talk to anybody you don't like. And if the sermon goes too long, you can always switch over and finish binge watching The Walking Dead or Outer Banks. No one will know. You will always find something more interesting or pleasing to watch than church. And if the preacher says something you don't want to hear, with a few mouse clicks or swipes, you can attend another church. Actually, just keep swiping until you find the church or preacher that says whatever you want to hear. There's never been an easier time to do some church shopping. And there's no shame in shopping around. No one really knows where you're attending church or what you're watching, except maybe Mark Zuckerberg or the folks over at Google. But they won't tell, at least not you. A church is defined by what it says about God and about Jesus and about the Holy Spirit. So church shopping is really God shopping. Maybe you can find another God that is more to your liking. To save you a few clicks and a little bit of time, let's look at some options. You could go to Buddhism, where Christ is not recognized as God, and Zen Buddhism does not affirm the existence of a living God. How about Christian Science? Christ is a divine idea, but his blood does not cleanse us from sin. How about Hinduism? You don't need a personal savior over there, and each one attains to becoming a god or cosmic consciousness. I don't think you have to do an offering there either. Islam, Jesus is a prophet of Allah, but was superseded by Muhammad. Maybe you'll like the Jehovah's Witness webpage. Jesus is created as the Archangel Michael, a lesser god, became only a good man, died, ceased to exist, was recreated as Michael again in heaven. Not God, no Trinity over there. The Moonies, Christ failed in his earthly mission, leaving the Reverend Moon to finish the task. Many believe Moon to be the Lord of the Second Advent. Or you could head on over to the Mormons. Jesus was born in heaven as the spirit child of Elohim, the Heavenly Father, by one of his wives. And Jesus' brother was Lucifer, who became Satan. And Jesus is just one of many gods. You could try Scientology. All are gods, including Christ. Or Seventh-day Adventism, which believes that Jesus is God, but also that he is Michael, and Christ did not complete atonement at Calvary. You could do Sikhism, which is a person works his way to salvation. If you work your way to salvation, you're absorbed into formless God. Or you could just head down Gola Road and become a Unitarian. Jesus is extraordinarily a good man. Do any of those suit your fancy? How will you know which one to follow? One problem is that we are unable to see God as he is because we are blind from birth. We see only glimpses of God. We are limited to what is called the natural knowledge of God. Using what we can see as our guide, we attempt to decide what God is like and who God is for us. Now, the opposite of deciding for ourselves who God is to listen to our Lord Jesus Christ. As St. John writes, no man has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him to us. So you don't trust your heart or your natural knowledge of God. You trust the word of Jesus. John 14. Philip said to Jesus, "Lord, show us the Father, and we shall be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long, and yet you do not know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe for the sake of the works themselves." If you claim to know God apart from Christ, then you don't know God. There is only one. Jesus Christ is the only one to leave heaven, come to this world, and reveal God to us. The God revealed in the ministry of Jesus is a triune God. He is vastly different from the 2,000 gods worshipped by the Greeks and the Romans and the 330 million other gods of the Hindu, or the godlike spirits of the New Age that you find deep inside yourselves. All the gods made up in all the world, all the gods created in the minds of all the scientists and in the logic of the philosopher, all the gods of heart and soul are idols designed in our own image to fit what we want them for. The only true God is a triune God, and he reveals himself to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. All others are idols, gods of our own making, to fulfill our own wishes and our own desires. First Chronicles, "For all the gods of the peoples are idols." To the Israelites who were surrounded by the gods of the heathen, God said, "Apart from me, there is no other God. You shall have no other gods before me." He is the God who entered our lives in the flesh of Jesus Christ. And since Christ's ascension, he has been operative in our hearts and in our lives through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, which we celebrated last week at Pentecost. God does not live up in your brain, and when you have God all figured out, then you've got him. God is known to us as he gives himself to us. God is received in the word, in the water, in the bread, and in the wine. We do not unlock the mystery of the Trinity. It is not the work of the philosophers. It is our task to receive him as he gives himself to us. Our gospel reading today from the last chapter of Matthew instructs us to go and make disciples, baptizing and teaching. The pastor, as the Lord's instrument, puts the Lord's name on us with the water, and we are baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and we are made children of God. And our whole life is taken into God, accepted by him, our brains, our hearts, our hands, our feet, and everything that is ours that he has given us is given to him, cleansed and forgiven and renewed. A church is defined by what it says about God and about Jesus and about the Holy Spirit. That is what is called a creed. The first creed of the church was, "Jesus is Lord." And that was the creed. And then they needed to expand a little bit as challenges against the faith came. And you had the Apostles' Creed, which we will confess later. And then you had the Nicene Creed. And then you had the Athanasian Creed. Each one adding to and saying more about Jesus. But all of them are simply saying back to God what he has said to us in his words. When you are baptized, you are baptized into the creed. And the creed gives us the words to say about God. It is not logic or philosophy. It is repeating back to God what he has first said to us about himself. We we don't search the world for God, or in our deep in our hearts, we find him as he has been revealed to us in his word and in the word that has been put upon us with the creed. The creed repeats God's words back to him, and the teaching of the creed: whoever will be saved shall above all else hold the faith which has always been believed. And that faith is this, that we worship one God in Trinity and Trinity in unity, neither confounding the persons nor dividing the substance. That is, don't squish together the three persons and don't break apart the one God. Three in one, one in three. Wherever the doctrine of the Trinity is abandoned, such is done in sects and cults, then another way of salvation is taught. You see, the Trinity, the teaching of the Trinity, brings us Jesus. If you lose the Trinity, you lose Jesus, you lose your Savior. And so all the ways of going that are against the creed, against the Trinity, end up losing Jesus. The scriptures say that all should honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. Those that honor not the Son honor not the Father who sent him. That is why we as Christians cling so strongly to the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. He is the only God we know, the only God revealed to us. And Jesus is the only God who hung dead on the cross for us at Calvary. That's the sort of God who saves us. It is the only God. The only God for us, the only God we confess, the one who hangs dead for us on the cross and who rises again to bring us to himself. In his most holy name, amen. Please stand as we confess our faith in this Jesus. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. O blessed and holy Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, hear the prayers of your people and grant to us all things according to your word and promise. Help us to see the imprint of your love in the goodness of creation and to exercise responsible care of all that you have entrusted to us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Help us to hear the voice of your word and to respond with faith, confessing you without fear before all people. As you planned long before the world began, deliver us in Christ, that we may be your own and live according to your commands all our days. Lord, in your mercy. Raise up faithful servants who will serve as pastors, faithful teachers and church workers who will heed your call and serve to the best of their ability wherever you place them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guide us that we may live out faithfully the new lives born of water and the Spirit, serving you with all our bodies, minds, souls, and strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In government and law, O God, work to establish and preserve order. Protect the weak and foster godly virtue. Bless our president, governor, and all who make, administer, and judge our laws. Lord, in your mercy. Deliver the world from the threats of pandemic and tyranny, and preserve the nations in peace. Bless all who defend us in the armed forces, especially Andrew, Job, and Sam. Aid us in emergency and medical fields, and inform us with news. Hinder those who oppress any peoples with mistruth, violence, or fear. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear us as we cry to you for the sake of the sick, the troubled in mind, and the wounded in heart, and those who grieve, especially Amy, Ed and family, Emma and Greg, Greg, Jessica and Job, Kelly, Kenneth, Kent and Shirley, Kimberly, Joe and Laurel, Mason and Max, Nancy and Paige, Paisley and Penny, Sandy, Sandy and Sarah, Sharon, Sharon and Sherm, Shirley, Susan, Susan, Sherry, Tyler and family, and all those we name in our hearts. Deliver them from affliction and sustain them in the hope with a patient heart and strength for the day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we thank you for a healthy birth of Quinn Denver, and for those who celebrate their birth, especially Troy and Alan, and for those who celebrate their life together, especially John and Darcy, Tim and Yvonne. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, in the blessed supper of our Lord, your Son has offered us his body as bread of heaven and his blood as the cup of salvation. Help us to receive this blessed sacrament with faith and to show forth the fruits of the Spirit in lives of faith, repentance, and goodness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the company of these saints, you have shown us that you will not abandon your people, but will keep them to everlasting life. Receive our thanks for those who have gone before us with the sign of faith and now rest from their labors, and bring us at last to dwell with them in your presence forevermore. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else you know we need, we pray you grant us, Father, for the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, through whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, both now and forevermore. Amen. We thank you for your continued support of Faith Lutheran Church. Your offerings can be placed in the basket on the way out, or there are three ways to give, which are also available. We continue now with our offering hymn, Praise to the Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, who with the only begotten Son and the Holy Spirit are one God, one Lord. In the confession of the only true God, we worship the Trinity in person and the unity in substance of majesty co-equal. Therefore, with angels, archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. You once revealed your name to Moses in the burning bush, and through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, you unveiled the mystery of your holy name in the Trinity of persons and the unity of being. Grant that we, who have been baptized and instructed in the triune name, may faithfully eat and drink of your Son's body and blood, and worship you in spirit and truth. O Father, through your Son in the Holy Spirit, hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We will be serving the Lord's Supper here in the church. And when we are finished here, we will move out to the driveway, inviting those who have been viewing from home and are members of Faith Lutheran Church or share our confession to come and receive the Lord's Supper in the driveway until 10:30 this morning. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.